Hello, everyone. My name is Jody Brandon. Welcome to Kids Discovering History. After the Civil War ended in 1865, three amendments were added to the United States Constitution. The 13th Amendment outlawed slavery. The 14th protected the rights of the newly freed slaves. And the 15th gave African American men the right to vote. During the period after the Civil War, known as Reconstruction, many African Americans were elected to high offices in the southern states. Some even served in the United States Congress. But once Reconstruction was over and federal troops left the South, many white politicians used corruption and force to reestablish their power. They met with little opposition from the federal government. Segregation laws, also known as Jim Crow laws, began to appear all over the South. African Americans were ordered to use separate restrooms, water fountains, restaurants, and bus seats. In the case of Plessy versus Ferguson, handed down in 1896, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that these facilities were legal as long as they were equal. Even though the facilities for African Americans in the South were never equal, Jim Crow laws governed the South for almost 60 more years. The struggle for civil rights was just beginning, and it would take the courage and determination of one man to see it reach its completion. That man was Martin Luther King Jr., and this is his story.
Martin Luther King Jr. was born on January 15, 1929, in this house in Atlanta, Georgia. His father, the Reverend Martin Luther King Sr., was a minister, his mother a school teacher. By 1932, his father had become pastor of the Ebenezer Baptist Church, one of the biggest churches in the city of Atlanta. Even though Martin grew up in the midst of the Great Depression, his father's position in the community allowed them to live modestly in a middle-class neighborhood. Being a bright, gifted student, Martin was allowed to skip several grades and graduated from Booker T. Washington High School at the age of 15. Martin enrolled at Morehouse College in Atlanta in 1944. It was here at this all-black college, known for its high academic standards, that Martin studied sociology and decided to become a minister. His father gave him a chance to deliver a guest sermon at the Ebenezer Baptist Church. Crowds of people came to hear young Martin speak. For weeks, people talked about the young pastor's forceful sermon. In 1947, he entered Crozer Theological Seminary in Chester, Pennsylvania, to obtain his divinity degree. It was at Crozer that Martin first learned of Mohandas K. Gandhi, a leader in India's struggle for independence from Britain. After many years of nonviolent protests, strikes, and boycotts, Gandhi and his followers finally won India's freedom in 1947. Martin was fascinated by Gandhi's methods of protest, known as passive resistance. He wondered if these nonviolent practices could succeed in America's segregated South. After receiving his divinity degree, he enrolled at Boston University to earn his doctorate in theology. While attending Boston University, he met and fell in love with Coretta Scott, a student at the New England Conservatory of Music. On June 18, 1953, they were married. The following year, Martin was invited to become the pastor of the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church in Montgomery, Alabama. Martin wasn't sure how to respond to the invitation. He and Coretta were not happy about the idea of moving back to the segregated South. But things were about to change. On May 17, 1954, the U.S. Supreme Court announced its decision in the landmark case of Brown versus Board of Education. It stated that segregation in public schools was unconstitutional. The 1896 case of Plessy versus Ferguson was dealt a decisive blow. Martin knew that this was the beginning of important changes for African Americans, and he wanted to be in the South to help. Martin accepted the church's invitation, and he and Coretta were soon living in Montgomery. He was awarded his doctorate from Boston University in June of 1955. He could now be called Dr. Martin Luther King. In November of that year, their first child, Yolanda, was born. She was the first of four children they would have together. All seemed right for Martin and Coretta, but that would change in just a matter of weeks. On December 1, 1955, a black seamstress named Rosa Parks boarded a bus in Montgomery, Alabama. When she was asked to give up her seat to a white man, she politely refused. She was told by the bus driver that if she did not give up her seat, he would have her arrested. Rosa Parks told the bus driver to go right ahead. She would not move. The bus driver stopped the bus, found a local policeman, and had her arrested. A friend named Edie Nixon posted her bail and later called Martin and Coretta to tell them about the incident. Nixon advised Martin that a boycott of the Montgomery bus system was the only way to show the city that they were not going to take this kind of abuse anymore. This was the beginning of the modern civil rights movement. What Rosa Parks did on that December day would make history. And for Martin Luther King, it was an opportunity to test Gandhi's practice of passive resistance. King called a meeting of African American leaders, including his friend and fellow pastor Ralph Abernathy. Together, they organized the Montgomery Improvement Association. King was elected president. The association decided that if the 50,000 Montgomery blacks stopped riding the buses, the city would lose money and that the boycott would gain national attention. They scheduled the first boycott for December 5th and started to spread the word. When December 5th arrived, not one African American was seen riding the Montgomery buses. They began to walk many miles to work. Black cab drivers drove as many people as possible for only 10 cents a ride. Carpooling became everyday practice. The city began to lose money, and city officials began a campaign of arresting the boycotters for any small violation. Martin Luther King was arrested for driving 30 miles an hour in a 25-mile-per-hour zone. A crowd of African Americans responded to King's arrest by quietly surrounding the jail. He was quickly released. Outside the jail, he spoke out on his opposition to violence.
We still advocate nonviolence, passive resistance, and still determined to use the weapon of love.
But violence was something that many African Americans would continue to endure. On January 30th, 1956, a bomb was thrown on the front porch of the King's home. Fortunately, no one was hurt. Martin knew that his struggle would constantly meet with opposition, but the bus boycott continued.
After 382 days of boycotting the Montgomery bus system, the United States Supreme Court ruled that segregation on city buses violated the Constitution and had to be abolished, and soon it was.
On December 21, 1956, Martin Luther King, Ralph Abernathy, and a white minister named Reverend Glenn Smiley rode in the front seats of the first non-segregated bus in Montgomery, Alabama. Gandhi's practice of nonviolent protest had worked and made Dr. King a national figure. In January of 1957, King, along with other black ministers, formed the SCLC, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. They elected Martin as their president. Their goal was to promote civil rights all over the South. In early 1960, Martin and his family moved back to Atlanta, Georgia, where Martin joined his father as co-pastor of the Ebenezer Baptist Church. On February 1st of that year, four black college students in Greensboro, North Carolina, sat down at a Woolworth's lunch counter and insisted on being served in this whites-only establishment. They never were. They were simply ignored. The word began to spread of these brave college students, and soon there were sit-ins at lunch counters all over the South. Dr. King's message of nonviolent protest was being felt everywhere. By 1961, many whites had joined King's movement. The Congress of Racial Equality organized what was to be known as the Freedom Riders. These were groups of blacks and whites who joined together to test the Supreme Court's ruling to integrate buses. They rode buses all over the South. Some of the buses were bombed. Some people were beaten by white mobs who met the buses at stops along the way. It was at these stops that the Freedom Riders would enter white-only facilities to non-violently protest the continuing segregation of African Americans. In the spring of 1963, King and his followers decided to peacefully demonstrate in Birmingham, Alabama. Many people considered Birmingham to be the most racially segregated city in the country. While they demonstrated throughout the city, the local police used fire hoses and attack dogs to deter them. King and several of his associates were arrested and put in jail. It was while he was in this cell that he wrote his celebrated document known as Letter from Birmingham Jail. In this letter, he responded to white ministers who had criticized his protesting in Birmingham. His reply to them was that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Film of the brutality in Birmingham made national news and led President Kennedy to go on television to ask all Americans to eliminate the practice of segregation from the country. On May 20, 1963, the Supreme Court ruled that Birmingham segregation laws were unconstitutional, and soon the laws began to change. King's peaceful demonstrations had worked. On June 19, 1963, President Kennedy delivered a civil rights bill to Congress for passage. King and other civil rights leaders decided to organize a huge demonstration in Washington, D.C. to show support for the bill. What would be known as the March on Washington took place on August 28, 1963. Over 250,000 people of all races and religions converged at the Lincoln Memorial to hear Martin Luther King speak of his dream of racial equality.
I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day, even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream. My four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.
The March on Washington was seen on televisions all across the country. It was the largest demonstration for human rights in the history of the United States. On November 22, 1963, President Kennedy was assassinated in Dallas, Texas. Upon hearing of this, King told his wife Coretta that he himself would not live to see 40. When Lyndon Johnson became the new president, he urged Congress to pass the Civil Rights Bill quickly in Kennedy's memory. In July of 1964, the Civil Rights Act became law, but voting rights and housing for the poor were not included. In December of 1964, Martin Luther King was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for his efforts to bring peaceful change to America. At 35 years old, King was the youngest person ever to receive this award. Now with the world's attention, King and the SCLC organized a march from Selma to Montgomery, Alabama, to protest the voter registration laws. These laws prevented African Americans from voting by means of poll taxes and intelligence tests. On March 7, 1965, the march began. King was advised not to attend as the leaders knew that there would be violence. As the marchers crossed the Edmund Pettus Bridge, state troopers ordered them to turn around. The marchers stopped but did not retreat. The troopers advanced and began pushing and beating the marchers. Tear gas was sprayed. Camera crews captured the entire incident on film to show to the rest of the country. A second march was attempted on March 9th. This time, King himself led the marchers. When they reached the bridge, they were again stopped by the state troopers. King told the troopers that the marchers would begin praying. They knelt and began to pray. When they were done, King turned around and led the marchers back to Selma. But he would not give up the cause. African American leaders petitioned the White House and Congress for protection, and they received it.
Their cause must be our cause too. Because it's not just Negroes, but really it's all of us who must overcome the crippling legacy of bigotry and injustice. And we shall overcome.
On March 21st, federal troops were brought to Selma to protect the marchers. King and his supporters marched 54 miles to Montgomery, a march that took 5 days. Along the way, they met with no resistance. When they reached Montgomery on March 25th, 25,000 people had joined them. The march was a triumphant success. On August 6th, 1965, President Johnson signed the Voting Rights Act into law. Soon, thousands of African Americans began to vote, many for the first time in their lives. Although the accomplishments made by King were many, he continued to speak out on civil rights and to help improve conditions for all African Americans. While planning a Poor People's March in Washington, King was asked by a fellow pastor to come to Memphis, Tennessee. Black sanitation workers had begun to strike in protest of low wages and poor working conditions. On March 28, 1968, he led a protest march of 6,000 people through the streets of Memphis. On April 3rd, as the strike continued, King delivered this moving speech to the congregation in Memphis.
We've got some difficult days ahead, but it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
The next day, April 4th, 1968, King was standing on the balcony of Memphis's Lorraine Motel with friends Jesse Jackson and Ben Branch. Suddenly, a rifle shot rang out and King fell to the floor. King had been shot in the head, and there was nothing his friends could do to save him. Martin Luther King was dead at the age of 39. When news of King's death spread, African Americans began to riot in over 100 cities in America. This was something that King himself would never have tolerated. Eventually, King's assassin was caught. His name was James Earl Ray. He pleaded guilty to the murder and is currently still in prison. On April 9th, memorial services were held for King at the Ebenezer Baptist Church. Dignitaries, politicians, and his many followers filled the church while an estimated 100,000 people heard the services on a loudspeaker outside. After the church service, his body was taken on a final march in a mule-drawn coffin to Southview Cemetery. A large stone monument was placed atop his grave. The inscription reads, "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, I'm free at last."
On January 15, 1986, President Ronald Reagan officially made Martin Luther King's birthday a national holiday. He is only the third individual to have his birthday so honored, the others being George Washington and Abraham Lincoln. Martin Luther King Jr. is remembered today as a true visionary in the fight for civil rights. His message of peace and passive resistance brought many advantages to millions of African Americans. So remember, kids, when we honor this great man every January 15th, we keep his dream of racial equality alive forever.